All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. So thank you everyone for joining us today. We're really excited for our second 2GM Town Hall meeting. Today we've got a great group of panelists. We've got James Klee, Puneet Bell, Paul King, Graham Roche, and myself will be moderating today for you. So a few things, I'm just gonna go over the agenda quickly and some housekeeping. So as a reminder, please do load up your questions and we'll answer as many of those live at the end of the session as we can. So just put them up in the Q&A and we'll get to them at the end. We do have an exciting birthday celebration to celebrate Grail's 13th birthday today. A couple announcements. You guys will be the first ones to hear since you're joining us today. Puneet's going to go over the state of Grails, and James will cover what's going on with Micronaut these days. Paul's going to give us some information on Groovy and Groovy 4, and then we'll get to your questions. So without further ado, we are going to celebrate Grails. So happy birthday, Grails. We have a little video that our OCI jam session created for you all, and a little bit of an interview with Sergio and Graham beforehand. We have Sergio and Graham here joining us, and we are going to talk about some Grails. I am super excited. So thank you guys for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Jen.
No problem. It's great to be here.
Awesome. So we are coming up on the 13th anniversary of Grails. Happy birthday, Grails.
No, that's crazy. Time really flies. It's incredible to think that was 13 years ago.
Yeah.
It first came out. So amazing.
So what are some things that you love about Grails?
I think that, you know, clearly there's a few standout features. I think, like, obviously Gorm is, you know, something that is always going to be my favorite. I think it really shows the power of Groovy as a language in terms of how expressive it can be. You know, struggle to find another data access framework that is as concise and simple to use as Gorm is. And so, yeah, I mean, look, I think Gorm is up there. The plugin system is clearly another big success story, and there's a lot of great plugins for Grails, particularly the Spring Security ones, for securing your application. Those are, you know, immensely popular, and, you know, just general the way it allowed the community to get involved, which was which is awesome, you know, carry it also to this day. Yeah.
What about you, Sergio?
So I came to Grails from Java, and I was not aware of Groovy. So I was introduced to Groovy because of Grails. And at the time, so there was not like JDK 8, and there was not like a Stream API. So all the Groovy features like were amazing. So all the collections, JDK and the whole collect final, Gorm was really nice. It was also really nice that it was like a framework that came with batteries included, so everything was ready to go to build things, and it was also ready to build applications in Spanish. So that was a big feature for me, because at that time, all the clients I was building applications for, they were like localized in Spanish, and Grails already came with all the internationalization system ready to go. So you just have to follow the conventions. And that was one really nice thing, that Grails came with conventions, and if you stick to the conventions, it was like someone guiding you through building the application. So really easy to build applications really fast. I think that's still the case, where many of the conventions we are doing, I'm doing now more support than writing applications from scratch. And there is some value to jumping into a code base and understanding like where everything falls. And that was something that Grails always provided, and it was really nice. And the multi-tenancy features is also some really nice thing as well. So I've seen many people build software as a service application with Grace. And it is because most of the pieces were there, right? So you just have to plug them together. The plugin ecosystem, as Graham said, is great as well. I remember one of the first Grace applications that I built was for a company who was organizing concerts. And we needed to generate a PDF for the ticket, and there was a plugin for that. We need to generate like an extra report for like the concert organizer to pay out the concert organizer. And there is a plugin like to generate an Excel file. So it was really like the plugin ecosystem was great and the community. So I was, where I am is a really small city and the greatest community close to where I live is great. And I met a lot of great people there. So yeah, the community has been a really awesome thing in Grace.
I completely agree. That's one of my favorite things is the community. I definitely think it has such a welcoming and encouraging and supportive community that's really excited about the technology and wants to be involved. And it's just really nice to see that and to be a part of it. So I completely agree. If you had to sum up Grails in one word, what comes to mind for you?
Probably productivity. So with Grails, you can, so at the end of the day, we like technology, but most of the time we have to build real things, right? We have to build applications and it is hard to think about a framework if you are in the JVM that allows you to build application faster. And it's not just to build proof of concept, because we have seen many people like having successful applications with a lot of load, right? But in terms of like being productive, like creating a project from scratch, creating it fast, that's what basically comes to mind when I think of Grails.
I love that. Productivity. Grails is productivity. Awesome. What about you, Graham?
Yeah, I'm with Sergio. It's the rapid application development features, you know, RAD or whatever you want to call it. It's, and I think that, you know, Grails has always been like really pragmatic in that sense, and Groovy as well. The two programmatic technologies of, you know, just about getting stuff done, right? Whilst other things would get in the way and whatever, you know, involve a lot of, you know, fluff. It was just, you know, just getting stuff done and making it quick and efficient to build applications that are already production and performant and scalable and all those things. And that's really what it's made Grails take off.
All right. Well, I think that about wraps us up, and I really appreciate your guys' time. Any parting words, anything that you'd like to say about Grails before we go?
Yeah, nothing. Happy birthday. Many more years to come.
Yes, indeed.
And keep groovy. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Happy birthday, Grails. And, you know, like, so here, it's one of many more to come, and, you know, the community continues to make it what it is today.
All right. Thank you, guys. Pardon the interruption, folks. I've just been given word that we've been given VIP access to a special OCI jam session where they're recording a special tribute for Grails. Stand by for more.
About it. When I want you to dance, take a chance.
another exciting announcement we have is that we would like to introduce a new mascot for Grails. So we're going to have a contest for the community to help come up with a name for our new knight. So here's a link. I'll also tweet that out. And there's some guidelines in there, of course, and it will, the contest starts today and will end in a couple weeks. And we're really excited to see all the names that you all come up with and excited that the community can participate. And we hope that you guys like the new mascot. Another announcement is that we are hiring. So if you want to be part of the Groovy Grails and Micronaut team, we have two opportunities for you to join. And here are the links, which we will send out on Twitter again for you to apply to. And I wanted to share that today because we have a great team and always looking for new folks to join and excited that we're able to do that. So next, Puni is going to go ahead and give us an update on the Grails framework.
Greetings, everyone, and a very happy new year. Starting 2021, we have some exciting updates around Grails framework and the release process. We'll be talking about end of life and and Grails, what new in Grails 5 and the road ahead. Release updates, we moved most of the CI builds from Travis to GitHub Actions and most of core projects. And we also adopted to semantic versioning with starting Grails 4. And so which means any major breaking change would go into a major version. And any minor release would have new features in a backward compatible manner, and patch release would just be drop-in replacement for you. So this makes it the release is more predictable and easy. And we also have a new release cadence. So earlier, especially in 2020, I do release in a Grails when and certain set of features or bug fixes are included. And unless those are not done, we don't do the release. But with 2021, we have this new release cadence where every 3 weeks we would do a minor patch release, which means that bug fixes and improvements would be quickly out. And then every 6 weeks, we would do a minor release, which includes a new feature, and a major release would be once a new year. And so end of life, Grails 2 would be end of life after June 30, that is the second quarter of 2021, and Grails 3 would be end of life after September 30, that is third quarter of 2021. We would recommend folks to quickly update to Grails 4 and plan it out. Can you please move to the next slide? Recent releases, we have released Grails 3.3.12, which includes update to the latest Groovy on that branch, and then Grails 4.0.7, which includes some important changes, such as you could now define a Groovy version in your project properties, and then your application would be using that specific Groovy version, and some bug fixes. Than the earlier Grails 4.0.6 release. And we also released Grails 5, which to avoid breaking semantic versioning. Earlier, we were releasing Grails 4.1.0 milestones, but to avoid breaking semantic versioning, we released that as a Grails 5 because that includes major breaking changes. The Grails 5, contains a lot of exciting features, and especially the features provided by underlying libraries. Some of the major highlights are Apache Groovy 3 and JDK 15 support. Groovy 3 brings a lot of new enhancements and new features, and some improvements around compile static. You could check out more details on the release notes for Groovy 3, but Grails 5 would support Apache Groovy 3 and Griddle 6, which brings incremental compilation supports and some new features. We also update to Spring Boot 2.4, which have some improvements around config processing and a lot of new features and Spring Boot 2.4 also update to Spring 5.3. So there are a lot of new improvements around in Spring and Spring Boot and major breaking changes. And we would also update to Spock 2, although the milestone is out. The GA is not available yet, but we have tested with the milestone and everything is working so far, so good. And Rails 5 GA general release, we had a plan to get the Rails 5 GA by March, which means the end of this quarter. But you know, there are some announcements on changes which may delay that, you know, Rails 5 release a little bit. And we'll talk about those in the next thing, that is JFrog. I know most of you might have heard that JFrog is now ending JCenter and Bintray. And we are in conversation with the JFrog team. And one thing is like the repo.grails.org, the Artifactory is not being terminated as part of this process and they would still support it. But for the plugins, it would be, and the community maintained plugin, it would be a major break change where we need to come up with some strategy around it in order to publish, where to publish the plugins and how we are going to deal with it. So the internal Grails team at OCI, and we are having an internal discussion, and as soon as we have a plan, which would be quick and soon, so we would share the same with the Grails team and the community. Next thing after Grails 5 is out, we would be working to make GSP more modular so that it can be used with other projects such as Spring Boot and, you know, outside of the Grails core. And we would be adding more documentation. And although we have introduced Grails 4 with Micronaut, you know, Micronaut parent application context, but so, you know, we would be sharing more information or blogs in terms of documentation, how you can leverage the benefits of using Micronaut in Grails application.
We did launch the Grails Foundation, which we're really excited to have help supporting the Grails project. So here's a link to go to the site so you can see. And it basically, very similar to what we're doing with the Micronaut Foundation, a non-for-profit organization to help support and lead the Grails project. And we are going to be offering corporate and community sponsorships to the Grails Foundation as well. So you will also see some limited edition swag items along with that, which is also really exciting to have. So we do rely on the support of our amazing community and generous sponsors. So we appreciate everybody's support, and we'll be sending out a link for you to see how to sponsor and donate and support the project. So James is going to go ahead and give us an update on Micronaut.
Everyone. my name is James Klee. I'm the Micronaut product development lead. And we'll just talk a little bit about what's happened with Micronaut since the last town hall meeting and sort of a little bit about where we're heading. So Micronaut released, so Micronaut follows semantic versioning. So we've had a couple of feature releases, so 2.2 and 2.3. 2.2, we had a lot of really nice improvements to our build plugins and some nice improvements to Micronaut launch. So now instead of always having to download an application from Micronaut launch, you can also push it right to GitHub, which is a really cool feature. And we're supporting Kotlin Gradle builds. We added a new integration with MQTT, so those in the IoT space can more easily use Micronaut for those solutions. And we released a Micronaut Data R2DBC integration in a preview mode. So we now support sort of reactive SQL with Micronaut Data. And among, there's obviously a whole bunch of other things that were included as part of 2.2, but you know, this is sort of what I could fit on the slide. And in 2.3, we just released last month. And that includes an integration with JMS, which is a messaging solution, We're supporting the latest Graal VM version, which was just released a few days prior to the 2.3 release. We did a final release of Micronaut Data R2DBC, so that's out of preview, and we added in some other features like to the server to support locale resolution. So you can simply like inject a locale object into your controller method instead of having to find it elsewhere. And we're planning on releasing 3.0.0 this year, likely this summer. And that will include a bunch of improvements that are breaking changes, right? That's what we can only make until a major version. So there's going to be a lot of improvements and changes there. So expect that this summer. And this is some stats about, you know, the community of Micronaut. Over 275 unique contributors to the Micronaut core repository, right? So this is, so I compared these numbers to the last town hall, and you know, obviously they're still increasing. 4.7K stars, over 1800 people in our Gitter community. So Grails uses the, you know, Slack, and Micronaut uses Gitter. So if you're using Micronaut, or if you have a question about Micronaut, I suggest joining the Gitter community. That's gitter.im/micronautfw. And lots of activity on Stack Overflow, 900 questions on Stack Overflow. And Micronaut Launch. So Micronaut Launch, we created back in May of 2020, and that's when we released it. And we sort of make a little note when somebody creates an application with it. And as of now, we have like 35,000 applications have been created with Micronaut Launch. So we're really happy about that stat, and it's just really happy that people are using it and finding success with Micronaut and our launch product.
That is awesome.
So what's next? So we have lots of things in the pipeline of things to do. Things like improved support for Kubernetes, like Kubernetes operators. Improvements to our bean container, right? So injecting with generics and improving qualifiers. We have lots of plans to improve our validation support, which we needed some foundational work to be done first. And so that foundational work is now done. And so now we can work on that for Micronaut 3. Support for Jakarta annotations. We currently just support the JavaX inject ones. And so we're going to support the Jakarta ones in a future release. And a bunch of other improvements with, you know, more cloud providers, more messaging solutions, and a lot more improvements to Micronaut data to support different non-SQL data sources. So document stores, graph data stores, and obviously a bunch of other smaller improvements to the framework.
And along with that, as most of you might know, and some of you who don't, if this is your first town hall, we did release recently the Micronaut Foundation as well to help support the Micronaut project. And again, here is the link and some information about that. And we also have sponsorship opportunities for corporate and community sponsors to help support the project as well. And Paul is going to go ahead and give us a Groovy update now. So Paul, we'll turn it over to you.
Thanks, Jen. I had a tough decision on whether to wear the Groovy t-shirt, the Grails t-shirt for the Grails birthday, or Micronaut t-shirt because it's a nice cool logo. So I've actually got a DevOps t-shirt on, and I'll explain that in my next slide. But before I do that, just a quick update. I'm going to give you some stats on what happened in 2020. We've all had a fun year in 2020, so we'll see what happened to Groovy. Then I'll look at a bit of the roadmap of what we've released recently, and then some of the stuff we're working on for Groovy 4. So we had some sad news a couple of weeks ago. Russell Window, one of our early contributors and also a contributor to many other projects, Jeepers, he was involved in early days of Gradle. He's had a thing called Gantt, involved in a lot of other programming languages, a lot of other parallel libraries. He passed away, unfortunately, and he was an inspiration to a lot of us. He had a passion for innovation, a passion for education, and he really inspired a lot of us. And so the t-shirt today is for Russell.
Thank you so much. We are very sad to hear that, and I'm so glad that you did bring that up here today. So thank you.
So what happened in 2020? 2020 was, it's a torrid year for most of us, but it was pretty much business as usual for Groovy. We had Groovy 3 came out early in the year, about a year ago. We've had 21 releases, all the different versions. So that's a pretty good year. We've had, that's about a tenth of all our releases since 2003 when we started. We had about a third of a billion downloads. So that's our best year ever. And if you look at the sort of yearly stats on downloads, it's still going up and up and up, which is great.
Fantastic to see.
So just in terms of where we're at, Groovy 3 is the version of Groovy that we're recommending most of you use. There are still people on older versions. So Jenkins folks are probably using 2.4. Not all of our, we've got most of, we're making good progress on getting Grails and Micronaut over to 3, but there's still some stuff on 2.5. We're slowly getting 4 ready. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. And that's our main focus. And we'll still be doing bug fixes for some of the older versions as required. But the focus is certainly at the 4 end of that list rather than the other end. Now, I'm just going to whiz through some of the things that are in Groovy 4. I haven't really got time to go into all the details. So please go and look at the release notes if you need that. Now, what have we released recently? So late last year, we did a release across all of the different streams, so 2.4, 2.5, 3, and 4. And that included a security fix related to temporary directories. So if you're using Groovy with temporary directories, go and look at the release notes and see if that's applicable to you. And if need be, I'd recommend you upgrade. Groovy 4 should be moving out of the alpha phase very shortly, and it'll be doing betas and RCs soon. Yep, thanks. So what's changed in 4? There's some detail here. Today's not a day to go into lots of detail, but just some quick things because if we need to get everyone's attention on these major things that have changed. Our coordinates have changed. So if you go looking for the Groovy jars, under Org Codehouse Groovy in Maven Central, you won't find any Groovy 4 jars there. They're all in Org Apache Groovy. So make sure you've made that switch. We promised in Groovy 3 to be moving over to have all of our modular jars that are in Groovy, make them all compliant with split packaging requirements. So we had some duplication of compliant versions and legacy versions of many packages like XML Parse or XML Slurper and so on. We promised that we'd make them compliant by Groovy 4, and that's what we've done. So make sure you go and start using the correct versions of all of those when you move over to 4. And we've listened to what modules people were using in the Groovy. We don't have a fat jar anymore for a split packaging requirements or JPMS requirements. We have a fat POM, and we had feedback that some of the stuff that was in the POM isn't being used much anymore. Some like the TestNG module and others were being used, like the YAML module. So we've tweaked those. If you don't want to be subject to the tweaks we're making on GroovyAll, which gives you the most relevant pieces of Groovy, just go get your modules directly, pick out the ones that you need. Another big focus for Groovy 4 is consolidation. So when we get a bug fix come in, we've had to go and fix old and new parsers, old and new bytecode generations, the static and dynamic parts of Groovy. So sometimes it's like 2 × 2 × 2, 8 different places that might be impacted by one fix. And sometimes we might fix up 7 of them, we miss one or whatever. So it's been a lot of work, and we don't really need a lot of this old legacy baggage that we've been carrying around. So old versions of parsers, old versions of bytecode generation are all disappearing. We've done lots of work on the parser. We've done lots of work on optimizing the INDI generated, the invoke dynamic generated bytecode. So it really now represents the best version of everything that you want, and that's what we're giving you in Groovy 4. So just a reminder, Groovy's got a dynamic nature and a static nature. And as part of when we introduced the static nature to Groovy, we added a type checker. Obviously, something similar to the type checking that Java or other strongly typed languages would give you, but we made the type checker extensible. And the idea was that people would come up with custom type checkers. And so if you've got a DSL, you might have less type information in that DSL, so you might want to make a weaker type checker. And other times you might not be happy with the type checking that Java is giving you, so you might want to have stronger type checking. And rather than forcing just one of those variants on you, we made it extensible. And we were hoping that people would start sharing custom type checkers around, and that hasn't really happened. So what we've done in Groovy 4 is we've started to bundle some type checkers in there, and we're hoping this will encourage more people to use them. And so the first one that's the first cab off the rank is a type checker for regex expressions. So that's in the next slide here. So the first block of code there is some code that you might have. It's Groovy code. It's dynamic Groovy. It's got a string representing a date, and it's got a regex that's trying to parse that date, and it's trying to group a year, a month, and a day. And we've accidentally left off the round bracket, which is the grouping bracket in the end of the regex. So we're not trying to give you a regex tutorial here, but both Java and dynamic Groovy, and even static Groovy with the standard type checker, will give you information at runtime that you've made a mistake. If you add the type checker, which is what the second block of code does, you'll get all of that feedback at compile time. So this is the kind of thing that we had in mind with the extensible type checker, and you can do this for SQL expressions and other things. This is the first one we've given you. That's an example. The second block of code looks a bit noisy, but you can actually make all of that type checking sort of noise go away by including it in configuration, but I just wanted to spell out how you do it longhand. So that's showing you how to do that. And this is showing you a whole bunch of different variants. Works when if you use all of the Groovy shorthands for patterns, the Groovy find operator, the match operator. If you use the Java API versions of all of these things, if you go and use, so just to show you, there's a foobar example halfway down the code there. It's looking for two groups of three lots of characters. And we can go and see that the first group is foo. So that's the first group of three characters. Obviously the second group is bar, but we asked for the third group and we'll get that feedback at compile time that there's only two groups there and we're asking for the third group. And that'll work whether you're using the Groovy matching operators or all of the Java API. So that's the kind of thing that you can do with the extensible type checker, and we're hoping there'll be more of these. The other thing that we're hoping there would be more of is more macro methods. So Groovy 2.5 introduced macros, which allow you to make it easier to write AST transformations. And the actual macro methods is these method looking things that don't need annotations that many of the AST transforms are triggered by, and it all happens at compile time. So this is a feature that we introduced that hasn't been used much, and we're trying to encourage it. So we're going to include some of the custom macro methods, and the first cab off the rank is the NV family of macros, which is on the next slide. So there's NV, which is name and variable, and this is something you'd do if you're doing system out print line sort of debugging, and you want to print out all of your variables. So I've got four variables, I want to print them out, and I could go and do that by hand, creating a custom two string. I could go and use some sort of shorthands in my IDE perhaps that might actually populate some of that stuff for me, but why not get the compiler to automatically generate those sorts of labels? And that's what's going to happen here, and that's all going to happen at compile time. So if we go one step forward, we'll see that at compile time. So this is the NV is not a method that's sitting around anywhere in a library. It's a macro that the compiler's aware of, and it goes and expands it out early on in the compilation before it does the rest of the compilation steps. And that's the kind of thing you can do with macros. And this is just, we're including some of these to give people ideas of the kind of thing that can be done. Some of you will have used the Groovy shell, which lets you compile up snippets of Groovy code. There's now a Java shell, and so you can actually compile up snippets of Java code. And we use this ourselves because in some of our tests, we want to compile up the code with the Java, some code with the Java compiler and also the Groovy compiler, and check whether things are similar, like similar modifiers, similar names of things, similar sort of bytecodes in some places. And so we use the Java shell for our own testing purposes, and we thought we'll make it available to everyone. So you can go and use that. This particular example is running on JDK 14, compiling up a record. And it's compiling up as Java. And then we're calling that created class and invoking it and using it in our Groovy code. And we plug that into the Groovy console as well. So you can actually go run as Java as well as run as Groovy. That's a handy feature. If you're actually using part of Groovy that's slightly different to Java, you can run the two and see how they both work out. Some of you may have used Groovy contracts or G contracts. It was an external library. We've bundled that into Groovy now. It wasn't being maintained very well, and it was important for us in terms of our future directions. Some of the things that it's doing are exactly the kind of things that we need to do for some of the future areas where we want to take the static compiler. So if you look at, design by contract lets you have class invariants and preconditions and postconditions for methods. And the idea is that you can, when you combine a system together with components, you reason about the larger system in terms of how the smaller components are interacting by looking at the pre and post conditions and the invariance of all of those components. And so that's what design by contract does. And the more advanced design by contract systems that are around do things like null checking automatically. So you've probably started using at non-null and things like that. Wouldn't it be nice if you didn't need to even add that in, and the compiler could do those sorts of things for you? All of the plumbing that G contracts or Groovy contracts does under the covers is exactly the kind of thing that we need to do some of that advanced functionality. So it's a good fit to include it. It's an optional module. You won't get it unless you specifically ask for it, but it's now there, and it's as we evolve Groovy, it's always going to be working. There's a POJO operation. So Groovy's got this static nature and dynamic nature, and the dynamic nature lets you do a whole bunch of very dynamic things. You can add at runtime, add properties and methods to classes and so on. If you turn it to the static nature, some of that dynamic features go away, but it's still a Groovy object and still knows about things like invoke method, get property, and some of the fundamental things that a Groovy object that people who are using Groovy will be expecting it to do. POJO says, see if you can go one step further and make the code even more dumber. So make it more like Java, more less dynamic things than even static Groovy. And that's really, really sort of handy for Java integration purposes. It's kind of nice, but it's also kind of handy for small classes that are almost like data classes, but we'll see something else that is good for them later. So what's the purpose of this slide? We've actually got a point class, a point list class, and we're using delegate, which is an AST transform. So this is a Groovy feature that's going to create all the boilerplate code for delegating to a list of points. And we annotate both of those with POJO, and the class that gets generated doesn't need the Groovy jar at all on the class path anymore. So if you've ever used something like Lombok, this is like making Groovy into Lombok. Now it won't work. So at the moment, it'll only work in it's incubating. It's experimental. Where this case here works fine, but if you start using some more of the elaborate AST transforms, at the moment, they don't fully go to code that doesn't require the Groovy jar. So don't go expecting everything to work just yet. But that's why it's incubating. That's why it's experimental. We're trying to push this as far as we can. And there'll be lots of scenarios where this is going to be really, really, really handy. Okay, the other thing that you may have seen in recent versions of Java is a record type. And there's a lot that we could talk about that. Go and read about why records are useful. They're very, very handy for classes representing simple data structures. And here we could, at the moment, we've got a thing called record type, and that'll give you something very, very similar to what a record in Java will give you. But you can actually go and do that on JDK 8. And in the future, we may have some syntax that looks a bit closer to Java's records, but that's not what we've got at the moment. We've just got the annotation, and we're going to explore that for a little while, and then we might give you the shorter syntax a little bit later. Now, it turned out to be very simple to build this. If you just look at the next slide, if you recall back in Groovy 2.5, we changed immutable into a whole lot of fine-grained features, and we used a thing called annotation collectors or meta annotations. Turns out that we can actually make the record type with just a slight variation of all of the fine-grained components that you see in that list. So if you go to the next slide, it's just a slight tweak to what we did for immutable, and that's how we get record type. And the nice thing about this is that if you don't like the way Java defined their records, you can define your own meta annotation and have yet another reworking of all of those fine-grained components and have something's different yet again to either our record type or Java's records. That's probably all we need to say. The final feature is language integrated query. So if you've seen C# for many, many years now, it's got a syntax that lets you write almost sort of SQL flavored looking C#. And we've now got that in Groovy 4. And so ignoring the first couple of lines, you can see from n in nums, group by, select, is even, count, max, and so on. So that sort of looks a little bit SQL flavored syntax. So that's what the language integration query is. If you run that, you'll get the result. That's the two string of the structure that comes back. You can see there that it's split that list into the evens and the odds. That's what the group by did. And it counted up that there was four odds and two evens. Seven was the maximum odd, four was the maximum even. And it worked out their averages of those two groups as well. Now it's fairly, it's backed by an API as the C# link is. So you don't have to use the DSL if you don't want. If you're trying to hook into at a layer that's got slightly different characteristics in terms of type checking and so on, it'll be more verbose, but you might find slightly better type checking or whatever. You can go to the API if you want. It's subject to change because this is an incubating feature. So just be wary if you're using that, it's more likely to change than the actual DSL, which maps down to this layer. Okay, it's feature rich. I haven't got time to go through them all, but it supports nesting. It supports aggregate functions. So we already saw that in the previous example with our odds and evens. There was count, and there's max, and there's aggregate, but there's also median, standard deviation, sum, variance, aggregations of various kinds, and more. So there's joining, sorting, filtering, pagination, window functions, updating, parallel querying, list comprehension. It's quite a fairly rich feature. So that's an example of, we've got a little bit of JSON. We're using the JSON slurper to parse that. And then we run our Gink Groovy integrated query on that. And we're saying, find the fruits where the price is strictly less than 32. Sort them by price descending and select just the name and price fields. And then we get mango, orange, apple, and banana coming out of that list in that sorted sort of list. Okay, so go and look at Link in more detail, or any of those features in more details, and give us feedback. There's some other things that I don't have time to talk about. We're looking at switch expressions, destructuring of various kinds, smarter type checking, and module definitions in Groovy. Want to see more, go look at the release notes. And for Russell, keep innovating and keep educating other people on all the stuff that we're doing. Thanks, everyone.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Paul. I appreciate that. And I'm sure everyone enjoyed all of the exciting things that have been going on with Groovy. So here is a list of some Micronaut community resources that we have. These will all be available in slides after that we will share with everyone as well. Here's some community links for the Groovy and Grails communities. But we do have a couple of questions that have come in, and I'm going to go ahead and read those, and then folks from the panel, please go ahead and jump in, and we can get those answered. So we do have somebody that is new to the Grails and Groovy community, and they wanted to know, they're on 2.5 currently for Grails, and what are some of the best resources for beginners and intermediate to read through and learn more of the frameworks?
Didn't you write a book, Graham, or something like that?
I did write a book at one stage, yeah. I think it's been a few editions since I can claim authorship rights on that front, but there are probably some more up-to-date books than the one I wrote. No small undertaking in that, by the way, writing a book. But yes, there's several books on Grails, absolutely. So available from your local, or not so local, Amazon, whatever it is, store. And there's also a lot of great tutorials and guides out there as well. So we have an awesome guides website, guides.grails.org, which has a whole bunch of things. A good place to start, I imagine.
Yes, we actually get a lot of really great comments from the community and clients about all of the wonderful documentation that you guys do for Grails and keeping all of that up to date for folks. So yes, we have recordings for on-demand viewing of webinars that are helpful, as Graham mentioned, guide documentation, blogs, and things like that. So if there's something that you are looking for in particular to help you all out, please do reach out to us and we will do our best to help you get that as well. We did have somebody asking about an awesome Grail shirt. So I was able to snag a few band retro tees, and the winner of the Grails Night Naming Contest will be getting one of those. And then we also have a few more. So Bill, I will reach out to you or send me an email and we'll see about making sure that you can get a t-shirt. And then we also have a question, is the data migration plugin going to be ready for Grails 5?
So most plugins should be working with Grails 5 and, if you want to try out database migration and there are some issues, we'll definitely look into it and try to work it out.
In general, it's expected that most if not all plugins for Grails 4 should work with Grails 5.
Right, yeah.
Okay, so I'll give a couple minutes if somebody wants to go ahead and post a question right now. I think that we've answered all of the questions that have come through. Oh wait, no, there's one more here. Are there any resources for guiding cost-effective deployment of Grails in the cloud? AWS, Fargate versus EC2, SQLDB?
I think there were some guides around deployment to cloud environments, but I'm not pretty sure. I can look it up and see if we can find and share that in the Grail Slack, if you're on the Grail Slack.
Yeah, so we will we'll definitely get you the information that you need there. So thanks for posting that. And then I just have a minute or two, so we'll hang out in case anyone has any questions for any of the panelists. And we wanted to thank you for your time again for joining us. And stay tuned for a webinar that we have coming up with Todd from Oracle. He's going to be giving us a great presentation next week. And then we also have a webinar on February 25th with our friends from Novatech and Camunda talking about their Micronaut integration product with Camunda. So thank you for joining us, and we'll hang out here for another minute or so in case anything comes in, and you guys have a great weekend.
So someone asked about any upcoming changes related to hot restart and reloading. So there's been some progress on updating Spring Loaded to support newer versions of Java. That's currently being led by Dave Estes. So I don't have any specific updates about, you know, like when that will be ready, or you know what sort of challenges may come from that. But as of right now, the recommendation for Java 11 and above is to either use Spring Boot DevTools or JRebel. For Java 8, you can still use Spring Loaded today.
Okay, and I think that's it. So we're gonna go ahead and wrap up for today. Thank you guys for joining us, and I'd like to thank my panel again for their time, and we will see you all next time. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.